I want to take you back, Representative, to before not just the 1-6 hearings, but the 1-6 insurrection. What was your relationship with Donald Trump like before all of this?
Well, after the election in 2020, I was the Republican conference chair at that point.
Right.
And we watched President Trump file lawsuits and allies of his file lawsuits, which, of course, was his right. But then we watched him lose each one of those, ultimately, I think 61 out of 60.
Right, more than 60, right, yeah.
But by about the third week in November, I was growing increasingly concerned because we were seeing these press conferences where, significant claims about criminality and fraud were being made by the president's counsel, but he wasn't producing any evidence.
Yeah.
And so at that point, I put out a statement saying, we're a nation of laws. You've been alleging criminality and fraud, and if you have evidence, you're obligated to produce it. But otherwise, your job is to enforce the rulings of the courts and respect the sanctity of our elections.
Yeah.
And it from there, obviously, became increasingly clear that he wasn't going to do that.
Did he respond to your statement in some way? Did he reach out to you?
I don't believe so.
Right.
I think that there were moments that we continued sort of, I think people thought, all right, well, maybe December 14th when the Electoral College meets, perhaps that's going to be the end, which, of course, it should be. And after the Electoral College met, again, we put out actually as a delegation, Senators Barrasso and then Senator Enzi and I together saying the election's over, Joe Biden is the president, and assumed, I think, at each step that Donald Trump would recognize his obligation, and, of course, he never
right.
did.
Now, I mentioned you voted with him a pretty significant amount of time. On the issues, you're okay with him, right? I mean, except for democracy. I know that's a little bit like, other than that, Mrs. Lincoln, how was the play? I understand that, but... But except for the issue that is now the issue, on the sort of more mundane votes that were cast in Congress, you actually didn't really have a problem with him from a policy standpoint.
Yeah, the place where I really had disagreements with him, and I spoke out when I did, was on foreign policy.
Right.
His statements suggesting that perhaps NATO was obsolete, for example.
Yeah.
When he stood next to Putin and said that he believed Putin's word about the 2016 election over Dan Coats, his director of national intelligence, who was standing there. So we had pretty significant differences on national security policy.
Right.
But in terms of, as you point out, my voting record, I'm conservative. And I think that what's really important to recognize is that we don't even get to have those debates about issues if we let the republic unravel. And we have to be able at a moment to say, look, the reason that we are able to, have a debate about tax policy or have a debate about military spending is precisely because we live in a nation where we're governed by laws.
Right.
And we get to debate, and then we get to decide what kind of policy we're going to pursue.
So you voted against the first impeachment.
I did.
And no regrets looking back over your shoulder at that.
No, I think it's very interesting. I think in terms of the first impeachment, they would have had more Republican votes if they had enforced their subpoenas. And that is certainly a lesson that we have taken into the January 6th Select Committee's work.
Right.
But look, I view impeachment, that vote to impeach is a very serious constitutional obligation. And in the first impeachment, looking at the evidence that was presented as opposed to what we were reading about in the news and ultimately what we read about in some people's books, the evidence wasn't there, in my opinion.
Yeah. You also voted for him twice for president, and you came to regret the second time at least, right?
At least.
At least. So I'm going to read back a quote. You were talking to Jonathan Carl in May. This is what you said. I mean, look, I was never going to support Joe Biden, and I do regret the vote. This is 2020, obviously. I think it was a vote based on policy, based on sort of substance and what I know in terms of the kinds of policies he put forward that were good for the country. But I think it's fair to say I regret the vote. You can't go back in time, but knowing what you know now, you change your vote. You don't vote for Joe Biden, though. That's not the change that you would make.
Knowing what I know now, I would not have voted for Donald Trump.
You're prepared just to leave it at that?
That is correct.
Yeah, okay. So, the hearings. Old conventional wisdom, these are going to be boring, deadly, dull, no news. New conventional wisdom, can't take your eyes off of them. I know there was an effort to so-called stage these hearings, right? You guys brought in people who had some experience at putting on a show. It didn't diminish the substance of the hearings, but you were conscious that the public would be watching, and you would either not get their attention or you would. Can you talk a little bit about the conversation around that, please?
Yeah, so we as a committee, first of all, the volume of information and the volume of evidence is very, very significant. And so we began by recognizing that we needed to be able to lay out what we had been finding in a way that would tell a complicated story with the most important facts and details presented. And so we made a couple of really important decisions. One was that we weren't going to operate like you've normally seen congressional committees operate, where each member has 5 minutes and then you go on to the next member. Instead, we divided up the hearings, and we said, you know, each hearing is going to have either one or two members mm-hmm. responsible for that hearing. And I think that has just made a huge difference, because then those members are able to delve very deeply into the material that they're presenting. Those members are able then to present the material. And in fact, the members themselves aren't the story. The story is the witnesses who have come and testified.
Right.
And I would say one of the reasons that we've been so effective is because of the witnesses. And the witnesses have been, the vast majority of them, have been Republicans.
Right.
So these are Republicans, and these are Republicans who were appointed by Donald Trump to the very highest levels at his Justice Department, in his White House counsel's office, in his campaign. Talking about the fact that, you know, for example, they all knew that the election had not been stolen from him by fraud, and that they told him so.
Right.
And so I think that the other thing that I think has really, I know it's resonated with me sitting in that room and listening and seeing the witnesses at the witness table, and I think it's resonated with people watching on television, is just the courage that you see. And while the last, you know, 2 years have been full of a lot of craven political ambition, have been full of a lot of behavior that the founders warned us against, they've also been full of a tremendous amount of political courage. And when you see people like Cassidy Hutchinson, who stood at that witness table and swore to tell the truth and told the truth.
Right.
When her, you know, people who were her supervisors, mostly men, who were many years older, have not had the courage to do so.
Right. I mean, you're talking about country over career. Exactly. Some of the decisions being made by these witnesses or against their own self-interest, but they're putting another interest first.
Exactly. They understand how high the stakes are.
You know that the process could have gone differently. There was, of course, initially a vote to create a more 9/11 style investigation of 1/6. And there was an effort to get Republicans equal participation on the committee. Kevin McCarthy, the minority leader, proposed some names. The speaker was not inclined to put those people on. And there's been some discussion now, well, what would it have been like if they had figured out a way to get ideological balance or balance by party on there? Have you thought about that? Are we better off the way it turned out, or would we have been better off, and would more people believe the committee's work if they saw themselves represented on that stage?
You know, I think it's a really important question that points to one of several moments over the last year and a half when the Republicans could have done the true and right and honorable thing,
right,
and did not. And, you know, you have to go back to the first plan, which was to create an external commission.
Right.
And it's really important for people to know the history of that, because what happened was, you know, Kevin McCarthy went onto the floor of the House of Representatives before the impeachment vote and said, we need a bipartisan commission to investigate January 6th. And he then instructed John Katko, who's the ranking Republican on the House Homeland Security Committee, to negotiate the terms. And the Democrats gave us everything we wanted. Split evenly membership on the committee, the staff split evenly, equal subpoena power, no sitting member of Congress. They gave us everything we wanted. And then at the last minute, Kevin McCarthy pulled the rug out from under Katko, I'm sure because Donald Trump called him. And so you ended up, it still passed the House. You had 35 Republicans vote for it.
Right. But
then it went over to the Senate, and Mitch McConnell killed it in the Senate. And I think that there was this mistaken idea that somehow if we had a commission looking at January 6th, it would be politically damaging to the Republicans. I cannot imagine why. I can't imagine also why or how you could in good faith say that we are not going to investigate the worst attack on the U.S. Capitol since 1814.
Yeah.
And so we... So once the Republicans killed the bipartisan outside commission, then there was a decision that had to be made, and the Speaker made the right decision, which was, we're going to form a committee.
Right. And with you or without you, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, she said, we're going to form a committee, and then the minority leader had the opportunity to nominate five members to the committee. Two of those five were Jim Jordan and Jim Banks, neither of whom should be on the committee. One and maybe both of whom are material witnesses to what was going on. And so she said, no, not those two, but we would like the other three, and we would like you to name somebody else. And at that point, Kevin McCarthy pulled all of his nominees.
Right.
So again, you're faced with this decision about, all right, can we really be a country where you don't get to investigate this attack because
right.
the minority doesn't want to participate?
But the complaints now that somehow we're not being treated fairly, you had an opportunity. That's the point. Right.
Yeah, you had an opportunity. And by the way, we have invited, as you know, witnesses, because they have relevant information, a number of Republicans. We have subpoenaed a number of Republicans and members of the House, and they've
yep.
chosen not to comply with the congressional subpoena. So I don't have a lot of sympathy for the idea that, you know, their voices aren't being heard.
Not fair. So you have a committee hearing coming up this Wednesday?
We do.
Tell us about what you have planned. Tell us the topic. Tell us the witnesses. Tell us the time of day so we can block out
right.
the time.
I'll tell you the time.
Oh, no, see, I listed that third. Hold on. What, in fairness, can you tell us?
That the hearing will be at 1 o'clock on Wednesday. And we will be presenting new information, new evidence, to the American people, because the investigation goes on. But I don't want to go any farther than that, as I'm sure my colleagues, Jamie Raskin and Adam Schiff, also did not do at this event.
Well, funny story.
Right.
Jamie Raskin was here yesterday with Bob Costa.
I heard, yeah.
Yes. And he, among other things, intimated that this hearing might be the last hearing that the committee has. Can you confirm that?
No, that's not right.
Okay. Okay, so this hearing will not be the last hearing that we will see. Not that your work stops.
We don't anticipate that it will be the last hearing.
Okay, so let me ask you about some specific things that have...
Well, I love Jamie Raskin, and he's great on this committee. I don't want to contradict him, so...
But you did.
Right.
I mean, if we're being honest about it, you did. All right, so a couple things have been in the news the last couple days I want to ask you about. First of all, within the last week or so, we learned that the Secret Service texts from the day of and the day before the 1-6 insurrection that we thought had gone missing have maybe gone unmissing, or at least you're able to get information that you didn't think you were going to have that tells you more of the story. Chairman Thompson has talked about this. Yesterday, Mr. Raskin talked about this. What can you say about that?
So we have received very significant production of information and material from the Secret Service. And
it was subpoenaed, right? Is that what I understand?
Yes. Yeah. And the Secretary of Homeland Security has worked in real cooperation with the committee and has brought in former General Counsel of Homeland Security, Steve Bunnell, who was a General Counsel under President Obama, to help ensure that there's good cooperation and production of you know what the committee needs and yeah. what the agency can turn over. So we've received a tremendous amount of information. And that takes the form of a whole range of types of communication. I will just
not just texts.
Well, the text messages themselves, in many cases, are gone. But there are other forms of communication,
right.
like Teams messages and emails and,
yeah.
and other forms of communication. And we have received, probably about 800,000 pages at least of material from,
wow.
from the Secret Service.
Now, again, I want to ask, just to be sure I understand this, it took a subpoena.
It took significant cooperation, a significant focus and attention and
well, why, Representative, why didn't they just turn it over when you asked? Why did it take you having to go back and compel them effectively to do this?
It is very, very troubling.
Yeah.
And again, I think if you look at what happened that day on the 6th, you'll see that there were Secret Service agents who were playing a hugely important and very courageous role. And I think that there are some who, have not been forthcoming with the committee, and you'll hear more about that.
Got it. Okay, second thing we learned in the last couple of days, in fact, Wednesday night, we learned that Ginny Thomas, the wife of Supreme Court Justice Clarence Thomas, who was pressing, as we understand it, Mark Meadows via text to take action on the president's false claims about a stolen election, has agreed to a voluntary interview with the committee. What is the timing of that, and what do you want to know from her?
What I will say is that we'll be speaking with her in the coming weeks, and I don't really want to go beyond that.
But you have an idea what you want to talk about.
I just don't want to share my...
You don't want to tell me. It says Texas Tribune Festival up there. Okay.
Sorry.
Okay. Any movement on Mike Pence?
Man.
We'll talk about your dad in a bit. For now, I want to ask you this. Any movement on the vice president?
So the committee is in discussions with the vice president's counsel. And what I would say about this is, number one, the vice president played a crucial role that day, not just in refusing. People should never forget that what Donald Trump was pressuring Mike Pence to do was illegal and was unconstitutional. And Mike Pence refused to do that.
Yep.
And so we owe him a huge gratitude because he did the right thing that day. I also believe that because of the gravity of what happened and the direct threat to the Republic, that he has an obligation to come and talk to the committee about his experiences and what information he has that's relevant to the committee. There are, of course, executive privilege issues, which I fully understand and respect. I believe in a strong executive, and I think executive privilege is a crucial part of our constitutional framework. but it's not absolute. And when you have a situation like we had on the 6th, where the president sent an armed mob to the Capitol to stop the counting of electoral votes, the vice president, I think, has an obligation to come and talk to Congress.
Are you optimistic, based on the conversations, that we will see him testify?
I am hopeful that Vice President Pence will recognize his obligations.
Would you like President Trump to testify?
Let me say that any interaction that Donald Trump has with the committee will be under oath and subject to penalties of perjury.
All right. So, as you know, Representative Cheney, there's a lot swirling in the air related to the former president. How do you think about the 1-6 investigation in terms of the fraud probe by the New York Attorney General or the Mar-a-Lago raid by the FBI? Are there any linkages between these, or do you view them as separate, kind of the coincidence of several different potential criminal acts playing out on separate stages?
Yes. Look, I think the 1-6 committee has a very clear obligation that's laid out in the resolution that created the committee. That includes the investigation. It also includes legislative proposals. We had our first major piece of legislation that came out of the committee was passed this week in the Electoral Count Act reform bill.
We'll talk about that. I'm interested in that. Yes, ma'am.
And so I think we are very focused on January 6th. You know, I think although the investigations aren't linked, I obviously have views about Mar-a-Lago.
Please share those.
Well, I mean, look, I think if you remember that the Republican Party has for so long been the party of a strong national defense. You know, if you look at the party of Reagan, the party that you could count on to protect the nation and protect our secrets, and then you look at how many senior Republicans are going through contortions to try to defend the fact that the former president had stored, you know, in a desk drawer, apparently, in an unsecure storage room, in a resort, some of the most, you know, documents that had the highest classification markings on them that we have as a government, and that they're looking for ways to defend that behavior, that they're attacking the FBI agents who carried out the lawful search warrant. I think it's the latest example of how fundamentally destructive Donald Trump has been. And part of the destruction that he's caused is, you know, the behavior that my party apparently now will accept. And if you sort of step by step begin to accept this kind of behavior, you know, then you really are chipping away at you know, a nation that's supposed to be a nation of laws.
So these are separate investigations, but there's some overlap, right? There are some issues that come up in common between some of these. Are you cooperating? If Letitia James, the AG of New York State, calls you, or if the Justice Department, I want to ask you about the broader question of the Justice Department and the committee in a second, but if they're saying, look, we're kind of swimming in the same pool, is the committee going to be willing to have a conversation about this stuff?
The committee is very focused on our responsibilities and our obligations. You know, we are absolutely, you know, as individual members of Congress and, you know, together, I'm sure, committed to the notion that it's very important that the Justice Department's prosecutions, and they've managed so far to obtain guilty pleas, including for things like seditious conspiracy.
Yeah.
You know, those are very important pieces of work the Justice Department is engaged in, but we really are separate entities working
right
on separate paths.
So the talk earlier this year about the committee's decision not to cooperate with the criminal investigation, you're at peace with that call?
I think what the committee has said is that You know, we are doing our work, and we have no plans right now to share transcripts, for example.
And you don't think, Representative, that there's any conflict between what you're doing and the Justice Department?
No.
None. Okay. Do you have any regrets about your primary, about things that you did or didn't do? Seems from the outside to be an honorable loss. You went down like Liz Cheney, right? You didn't turn yourself into something else.
Lose it like Liz. That's great.
Right.
Thanks.
Lose it like Liz Cheney. That would sounds like
a
viral dance song, doesn't it, actually?
Right.
But in all seriousness, you didn't do something different, speaking of contorting, simply because you thought, well, if I do this, maybe I can hold my nose and win my primary. Tell me about your calculation on that.
Yeah, I mean, look, no, I have no regrets. Certainly, ever since the impeachment vote, I got a lot of incoming calls from Republican leaders telling me, you need to just stop talking about Donald Trump. You know, you need to, you know, just sort of ignore him and he'll go away. You know, I never could understand sort of how you would do that, because what he for us as a party, the choice is either you're going to accept what he did, or you're going to be clear that what he did has no part in the politics of this nation. And there's not a middle ground given what he did. And so, you know, I knew all along that I was not going to be in a position where I would, you know, try to contort myself to suggest yeah. that what had happened was somehow not as grave of a danger or that he shouldn't be held accountable. I've certainly seen many of my colleagues do that, and I think it's a very sad thing.
So let me be clear. The Republican leaders who are calling you are telling you stop talking about it. Are they also telling you, we agree with you, but we can't say anything, but you should know that we think you're right? Did you hear any of that?
Yes.
Yeah.
So I would get calls saying, hey, look, we all know what you're saying is right, but we all think we should stop talking about it.
Profiles and courage, huh?
And I also got some calls saying, hey, we all know, like, what you're saying is right, and we think you should keep talking about it.
Right. They want you to walk the plank on their behalf. There was a moment in the primary. Of course, this is Texas, not Wyoming. We don't ordinarily pay attention to a Wyoming primary, but this time we were paying attention. And there was a moment in the primary when you put out an ad that featured your dad, who we still know a little bit about in Texas. This is a quote from your dad, direct to camera. In our nation's 246-year history, there has never been an individual who is a greater threat to our republic than Donald Trump. Yeah. Dick Cheney. Can you tell me the calculation that he went through or you went through for him to get in? I know you're his daughter. Dads do things. I get that. But this is the former Vice President of the United States saying that a former President of the United States is the greatest threat to the Republic ever. That kind of stopped me in my tracks.
Yeah, I mean, you know, that he has watched what's happened since the 6th.
Yeah.
And he's really deeply troubled by it. And that video, you know, we started and the idea was, he and my mom had actually just voted. They did early voting, and they voted for me. And so the idea was my dad was just going to make an ad saying, you know, I voted for my daughter Liz, and I hope you will too. You know, Cheney for Wyoming. And when we sat down to make the ad, he said, I have a few other things I want to say.
So he did that in the moment?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. And when Dick Cheney says, I have a few other things I want to say, you say, okay. but it's a very serious thing. I mean, look, he's a student of history.
Yeah.
Obviously, somebody who has served at the highest levels of our government, somebody who, you know, has studied and lived through and dealt with some of the most significant challenges we faced as a country.
Yeah.
And to hear him say, you know, that there's never been an individual who's a greater threat is something I hope everybody will just stop and think about what that really means.
You know the woman, Harriet Hageman, who's replacing you in Congress. You know her.
I do.
Yeah. What do you think of her? And let me ask the question directly. I think I know the answer. Will you vote for her?
No. You know, Harriet's a member of the Wyoming State Bar. And she's sworn an oath to the Constitution as a member of the Wyoming State Bar.
Yeah.
And she continues to make the assertion that somehow the 2020 election was stolen. Says many of the same things that have resulted in people like Rudy Giuliani having his license suspended. And I know that she knows better. And I think that, you know, there are many people around this country who are making claims they know not to be true. And I don't think anybody should vote for any of them.
Okay. So, all right, Representative, let's look ahead. Let's look ahead. You mentioned the electoral count reform legislation that you and Representative O'Loughlin, Democrat, co-sponsored, passed this week in the House with the votes, I should note, of 9 Republicans, none of whom are coming back to Congress. Again, profiles in Courage, right? You can only get 9 votes for a bill that says such controversial things as the vice president can't decide who's president because he feels like it. I mean, that's effectively one of the key provisions in this, that the vice president's role at the count is ministerial. Vice president doesn't have the power to unmake the account. Raise the objection threshold to 1/3 of each house, up from a single member of each house. That would be a change. Explain that, please.
Yeah, well, let me say first that it's again, really important to note, first of all, Zoe Lofgren, who is the chairwoman of the House Admin Committee, who's somebody I really did not know before I began serving on this committee.
Member of 1-6, too.
Yes, she served on the committee with me, and I have huge respect for her. Again, you know, we disagree on a lot of issues, but in terms of somebody who is hardworking and dedicated and diligent and wants to get it right, there's nobody who is better than Zoe at those things in the House, and I'm really proud to work with her and proud to call her a friend. And we really approached this bill in a way that, you know, we consulted with constitutional scholars all across the spectrum. We put aside partisan issues, and we also said, let's be very clear, you know, because Donald Trump seems to like to say, well, they're reforming the law because I didn't break it. No. What Donald Trump did was illegal and unconstitutional under existing law, and it would also be illegal under this new law. So nobody should have any doubts about that. We looked at the existing Electoral Count Act, and we said, what are some of the things we need to do in order to prevent people in the future from trying to steal elections? And the Senate has also been at work on this,
right?
And they've done important work. We've done important work.
Not exactly the same.
No, I mean ours is better, but but important things. For example, we raise the threshold. We also make clear that, you know, the Constitution says that state legislatures determine the manner in which electors are selected, and our bill says that those laws have got to be passed before an election. You cannot, in other words, retroactively
wait for a result you don't like.
Exactly.
Right.
And then say, we're going to change the manner.
And then go back.
Right.
Right.
So.
And the other one that I thought was interesting was that this legislation would prohibit election officials from willfully refusing to count ballots or certify elections.
Yeah.
So the Senate bill will happen. Do you think you'll be able to find common purpose and we'll get something passed?
I do. I think the Senate is going to be marking up their bill next week.
Yeah.
And then I think we'll be able, there's enough support for getting something done that I think we will. And I think, you know, the other thing that this bill does that's very important, and this is very important looking to 2024, and you mentioned it, that, you know, we ensure that if you have a Secretary of State or if you have a governor of a state, they can't simply refuse to send a certified state of electors because they don't like the outcome. And, you know, we ensure that they have the ability to go very quickly to a three-judge panel and then to the Supreme Court in an expedited fashion.
Right.
Presidential candidate has that right under our bill. And I think that's going to be very, very important.
So how worried are you, Representative, about elections this fall in which you have a number of candidates who have shown their true colors on denialism and are running for positions that could give them disproportionate power over how elections are administered? I mean, you want to get this bill passed, you want to get it put into law, but are you really going to prevent the election of people in states running for Secretary of State, running for positions at the local level, who are going to have their hands on this stuff?
Well, I think we have to do everything we can in 22
right.
To make sure that those people don't get elected. And
but you know that some will get elected.
And that's why our bill is so important in order to prevent what we think might happen in 24. But I think this is a much bigger issue for us as a country than just the 22 cycle and the 24 cycle.
Right.
And it's about whether we're going to demand of our elected officials that they fulfill their oaths of office. And whether we're going to recognize that partisanship has to have a limit. You know, there's got to be an end. And if we go down the path, and I would give you an example. I think, for example, that Governor Youngkin in Virginia is doing a good job. I think that he's demonstrated that he's somebody who has not bought into the toxin of Donald Trump. But he campaigned recently for Carrie Lake. He went and campaigned.
Republican candidate in Arizona for governor.
Right. Who's an election denier, who is dangerous. And that's the kind of thing we cannot see in our party. We cannot see an accommodation like that. And I think it's very important that we be clear about that.
So are you going to campaign for Katie Hobbs, the Democratic candidate for governor in Arizona, as a result of that?
I'm going to do everything I can to make sure that Carrie Lake is not elected.
So does that include campaigning for Democrats if that's what it takes?
Yes.
It does. Okay. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Let me ask my colleagues to put the phone number back up to text in questions. We're going to talk a little bit longer, and then we're going to go to audience questions. 2022 election. Are the Republicans going to take back the House?
I think it's a closer run thing than people think. Obviously, Republicans have the advantage right now if you look historically at the midterms and at the numbers at issue. But also the way that the districts get drawn.
Yeah.
But I think that, you know, the independent voter and the moderate Democrats and the moderate Republicans around this country want sanity. And they want responsibility. And they want to know that their elected officials are serious. And so, you know, I would urge people when they're, you know, going to go into the voting booth and cast their vote, policy and substance matters, no question that it matters. But you ought to think very carefully about making sure the people you vote for are serious. And I mean that on both sides of the aisle.
Yeah, yeah.
We need competent, serious people making these decisions.
At this point, Representative, would you prefer the Democrats hold the majority to the Republicans winning it back?
I think that it's a tough question.
Or it's an easy answer.
No, I mean, look. I think that the policies of the Biden administration, you know, there are a lot of bad policies in terms of, you know, for example, what we're seeing now with respect to inflation, what we're seeing with respect to government spending. And so, you know, I'm not a supporter of those policies.
Right.
And I think that it's very important that we not create a situation where we get more of those policies. I think it's really important, though, as voters are going to vote, that they recognize and understand what the Republican conference consists of in the House of Representatives today.
Yep.
And how much power the election deniers, the people like Marjorie Taylor Greene and Lauren Boebert and Jim Jordan, how much power those people will have in a Republican majority. And I think that's a dangerous thing for the country.
Should Kevin McCarthy be Speaker?
No.
No. Okay. Just fine.
I say that because the Speaker of the House is the second in line to the president.
Yeah.
The presidency after the vice president. And at every single moment when, you know, our time of testing came and Kevin had to make a decision about what he was going to do, he's made the politically easy for him or the politically expedient decision instead of what the country needed.
Right.
And I think that, you know, somebody who's going to be that close to the presidency needs to be somebody who's faithful
right.
to the Constitution.
Do you have any doubt, Representative, do you have any doubt that if the Republicans take back the majority, they will kill the 1-6 committee?
No, no doubt.
No doubt at all. Okay.
Oh, and I think people ought to also think about that.
Yeah. That to be a thing that people vote on the basis of.
Yeah, people really ought to stop and consider what it means that the Republicans don't want January 6th investigated. Yeah. Why are they working so hard to keep it from being investigated?
Are you going to run for president?
I think about this. This is a question that I get.
Sure.
You may have known that.
Yeah.
But I think it's really important not to just immediately jump to the horse race. And I think about what we need as a country. And, you know, we have to step back from the abyss. And we have to recognize that there's this shift going on in our politics, that the tectonic plates are shifting. And that means that we all have a responsibility to say to ourselves, what are we going to do to make sure that our kids, you know what it means to have peaceful transfers of power? And what are we going to do to make sure that we don't contribute to unraveling of the republic? And I think that's a much bigger question, and that's what I'm focused on rather than who's running and...
Right, but what's the mechanism? But of course, Representative, if you're a former state representative, it's one thing. You don't have the stage that you have had or that you would have if you chose to seek office at the highest level. So what's the mechanism for carrying that message?
Well, I don't think you should doubt my capability to do that.
Oh.
But
peace.
You know, I have been incredibly moved. Look, when you're an elected official, I think all of us are accustomed to people who come up to you and say, thank you for your vote on tax policy, or your vote on tax policy sucked. I mean, you get both of those things.
Yeah.
But there's something else that is happening around the country now, because people understand how high these stakes are. And it's not about me or making a decision about what I'm going to do. It's about making sure I do whatever I can do to make sure our politics rights itself, and to make sure that, you know, we face huge challenges. And we cannot afford to be a society where we're tearing each other apart. That's what our adversaries want us to be doing.
Right.
Think about the fact that what the leaders of the Chinese Communist Party say about American democracy. You know, they say our elections can't really, they don't work, they don't reflect the will of the people. Those are the same things Donald Trump says about our democratic process. And we have an obligation to make sure, and I certainly will do whatever it takes to make sure Donald Trump isn't anywhere close to the Oval Office again. Right.
And last thing on this, and if that means, if you determine between now and whatever point that the best way for you to keep him from winning the presidency again is for you to seek it yourself, you're holding open the possibility.
I will do whatever it takes to make sure he's never near the White House.
Okay. Representative, I'm going to invite my colleague Brandon Formby, one of our editors on stage, briefly to ask questions on behalf of the audience. Brandon, please give us your best shot here.
Assuming that the margins of victory in the upcoming midterm elections are going to be slim, how or what can be done to ensure that the integrity of the results will be upheld and the duly elected officials get to take their seats?
Well, I think this is one of many reasons why elections matter so much. And it's the point that Evan and I were talking about, that in this election, you have to vote for the person who actually believes in democracy. And that is just crucial, because if we elect election deniers, if we elect people who've said that they're not going to certify results or who are going to try to steal elections, then we really are putting the Republic at risk.
And look, may I follow up on that, just ask the representative, please? So in a place like Pennsylvania, for instance, where you have a race for governor between the current Attorney General Josh Shapiro and Doug Mastriano, who is an election denier himself, should Shapiro win that race, polls are suggesting he might, it seems entirely plausible that Mastriano will claim that the election was stolen. What is the recourse in that case for people in Pennsylvania, or for that matter for Shapiro? Do they just ignore Mastriano, don't give him any oxygen so the match extinguishes? What do they do in that case?
I think that what happens in Pennsylvania, first of all, we have to make sure Mastriano doesn't win. Right. Secondly, I think that this goes back to the responsibility and the obligation of elected Republicans. And this is why it's so dangerous when you have, you know, the leader of the House of Representatives suggesting that the election, you know, and you can go back and look at what he said in the days after the election. Well, it's not over. Donald Trump won. When you have the leadership saying, yes, you know, there was fraud sufficient that it could have overturned the election. It's those words matter. And we have to have leaders who understand that this isn't a game. So that means you have to elect the right people in Pennsylvania, and you've also got to elect the right people at a national level and to federal office representing Pennsylvania. But to me, that's the fundamental test in this cycle.
Brandon.
Realistically, what will the consequences of the committee's work be for Trump?
Well, our responsibility and obligation is both to investigate, to make legislative proposals, potentially to make criminal referrals, and so our work isn't done yet, and we'll see where that goes. But I think certainly the extent to which we've been able to lay out for the American people what happened, and let me just say on that, one of the things that has surprised me the most about my work on this committee is how sophisticated the plan was that Donald Trump was involved in and oversaw at every step of the way. It was a multi-part plan that he oversaw, he was involved in personally and directly. And whether you're talking about the effort to pressure the vice president, his efforts to corruptly pressure the Justice Department, state officials, and I think making sure people around the country understand this point. On January 6th, while the attack was happening, while police officers at the Capitol were being beaten, while they were engaged in medieval hand-to-hand combat, while the violent mob was attempting to stop the functioning of our democracy and assaulting our Capitol, while his family was pleading with him to please tell the mob to go home, while his most senior officials were pleading with him, please tell the mob to go home, while leaders in Congress were begging him, please tell the mob to go home, Donald Trump wouldn't. And just set the politics aside for a minute and think to yourselves, what kind of human being does that? What kind of human being sits for 187 minutes when he's the only one who can stop it, and he knows what's happening, and he refuses to take action? And I think that part of our obligation as a committee is to make sure people understand and know what he did and what he didn't do.
Is it possible that believing... You've just made a number of declarative statements. No hedging. He did this, he did this, he did this. Can you see a scenario where what you just said is what you believe and there's no criminal referral?
Well, I don't want to get ahead of the committee on this.
Well, I understand that. Does this work in such a way where the committee has to be unanimous in its decision to make a criminal referral or to take any other action on the back end of this?
I think we will be unanimous.
You think you will? Okay.
Well,
Brandon.
In whatever action you take,
you think you're not going to have to be, you know, shopping for votes on the committee? No. Okay, Brandon.
Do you think that Trump brought your party to the state it's in now, or were there already conditions within the party that brought about his emergence?
That's a great question.
Yeah, I mean, thinking of it, I think that there are a lot of problems in both parties in America today. And so I don't want to say the Republicans are solely responsible for where we are politically. And I also don't think that Donald Trump is part of a continuum. I think that Donald Trump is the only president in American history who refused to guarantee a peaceful transition of power. And so now, the fact that my party has refused in the months since then to stand up to him, I think does tell you how sick the party is and how much work we have to do to get back to a place. The country's got to have, you know, a party that believes in conservative principles and values and stands for those things. And we need to have a strong Democratic Party that, you know, is fighting on the other side so that we can... Yep. Have substantive debates. So I do think we need to get back to a substance-based politics.
You used the phrase "my party" just now. I know that Jonathan Carl in that May interview asked you if you would remain a Republican if the party nominated Donald Trump again. I noticed you didn't actually answer him. So I'm going to ask you, will you remain a Republican regardless of what happens in the next election?
I'm going to make sure Donald Trump, I'm going to do everything I can to make sure he's not the nominee. And if he is the nominee, I won't be a Republican.
Okay. Thank you. Brandon.
Do you think that your party could be saved from Trump?
I do. I believe deeply in what my party has stood for, and I believe in its history. And I when I look back at, obviously, the beginnings of my party with Abraham Lincoln and leadership of presidents like Dwight Eisenhower and certainly Ronald Reagan and the Bushes and Gerald Ford. I mean, I'm very proud of my party. I also believe in limited government, and I believe in a strong national defense and low taxes. And I think we have to have a Republican Party that can be trusted to fight for those things. And it can be trusted by, we have to be able to get independents to vote for Republicans if we want to win elections. And to do that, people have to be able to trust us. The Republican Party didn't have a platform in 2020. And I think that tells you a lot about the hard work we have to do. I'm not ready to give up on the party yet.
Got it. Yep. Brandon.
This question comes from a conservative audience member. They believe that Biden won. Would you advise them to boycott the midterm if the Republican candidates claim that the election was stolen?
No, I would advise them to vote against the election deniers.
It's better to stay in the fight than to withdraw in them.
Yes. I really believe that, and I say this as somebody who's worked in countries around the world that aren't democracies the Middle East and in Asia, in Africa. I worked in Eastern Europe right after the wall came down. So I've seen societies where people are either struggling to gain their freedom or where they aren't living in freedom. And it is really, really fragile. And we have become accustomed to thinking, you know, well, the United States, we could just take for granted that we are going to be a constitutional republic. And what we've seen over the course of the last couple of years is how that foundation is being chipped away at. And the most important obligation not just elected officials have, but every single American, is to do your part to make sure the people who believe in what the election deniers are saying, the people who would tear the republic down, don't get power.
Okay. We've got time for a couple more. Go ahead.
Texas's Attorney General Ken Paxton was at the Stop the Steal rally. He also filed a lawsuit to try to overturn the results in some of the battleground states. Is the committee going to be looking into his role on January 6th?
Well, I don't want to comment with respect to the committee, but the lawsuit, the Texas v. Pennsylvania lawsuit, was absurd, there was an effort underway to get a number of Republicans, and successful effort to get a number of Republican House members to sign an amicus brief in support of Texas's position, it was, you know, absolutely clear, particularly when you had allegations that were made about how other states had conducted their elections. Pennsylvania in particular, and the officials in Pennsylvania said it's just not true, that what you're saying about the way we conducted our elections is false, what you're saying about the rulings of the courts is false. It was without merit and should not have been filed, and the Supreme Court handled it the right way.
Since January 2021, what is the best piece of advice that your father has given you?
That's a great question, too.
I talk to him every day, and so it's hard to pick one. But one moment I won't ever forget was actually on New Year's Day this year, and we were leaving their house, and we'd been talking about everything that was going on, obviously. And as I was leaving, he gave me a hug, and he said to me, "Defend the Republic, daughter." And I will.
Good. All right. Great. Thank you. Good. All right.